All right, hello, my friends. Today, you and I together are going to build the world's best random number generator. Nothing will be able to defeat this random number generator. You've heard there's all kinds of uses for random numbers, from encryption to simulations and all kinds of things, and they're very important. And what usually happens is there's always a suspicion that the random numbers they're using are not truly random. And so we need to understand what truly random is and how it applies to this perfect, absolutely perfect random number generator that we're going to build. Now, there's all kinds of tests that have been invented to see whether the numbers that are produced from random number generators, including this one, including any random number generator, are so-called truly random. So I want you to use whatever algorithm you're going to favor for yourself. And there's all kinds of them. If you're a specialist in this, you'll know them already. If not, it's not really important. You'll have to take my word for it. But if you do, you could use the whatever computer you like, whatever algorithm you like. You could get the world's fastest and best supercomputer. You could get the world's best and fastest quantum computer, or just imagine that you have access to these kinds of things and see if you can prove that this thing is either random, truly random, whatever that means, or non-random. Now, what do I mean by this is a random number generator? So let me be perfectly clear. This is a box of matches. It's from a restaurant, a Spanish restaurant, a very nice Spanish restaurant, closed long ago in New York City on 73rd Street. Had very nice paella, big giant pictures of sangria, very cold, crisp, delicious, long gone. But I picked these up. I picked these matchbooks up. I have several of them. Here's another one from McCormick and Schmick's. I think this one's from from Bethesda, Maryland. Now I don't collect these things or anything like this. But back in the old days, restaurants used to hand these out, and you could pick them up and you could use them to light your pipe or cigar or something like that, which is the use I put them to. So I don't collect them to have them as keepsakes or anything like that, but I did collect them to use. So I have a number of these things. I have a number of these matchbooks, but we're not going to count this one. This one's the one that's going to be our random number generator. Inside this are, presumably, a number of matchsticks. I took this one out of the McCormick and Schmick's box. This is it, a matchstick. You've seen these before. I don't know if the ones inside here are of the same manufacturer as the ones that were in here, so I can't say anything about that, but we have to make some sort of presumption, do we not? And that presumption will be crucially important, it will turn out. So, presuming there is something like this, there is a certain number of matchsticks in here. In fact, that number is random. I have just generated, using this perfect random number generator, a random number. There's a random number of matchsticks in there. Now, you have all the information you need to determine whether or not this random number generator is a perfect random number generator in the sense that it generates a number that is truly random, or it's an imperfect number generator, random number generator, and that's somehow not truly random. So let's have a dramatic pause here while you pause and think about how you could prove this one way or another. You have all the information you need already. Okay, well, I hope you've all had time to employ your random number generator tests or random number tests and everything and determine whether this is truly random, the number coming out of this, or it is only pseudo-random or not random at all. What did you come up with? Well, you should have came up with that it is truly random, because what does random mean? In spite of what you might have read from other places, random means unpredictable. You don't know what the number of matchsticks are in this box. You don't know. Know is a very strong word, the strongest we can have when we're thinking about thinking. To know means to believe a truth. And there is, in truth, a number of matchsticks in here, but you don't know it. Now, you might guess it. You might say the there's one, and that might be the right number, and you have guessed correctly, but you did not know that. You just merely guessed. And one way we can think about that is that would you be willing to bet your life, everything that you have, everything that you are, in the very life blood that courses through your veins, would you be able to bet that on the knowledge that your guess, or on the belief that your guess is perfect? Now, most people would not. But that brings up a whole other area of thought about how to handle bets and so forth, and how they relate to probability. We don't need to get into that today. However, there are a certain number of matchsticks in here, and that number is random. None of you know it. We might be able to say, well, here's this one right here, and maybe doing, if you took the time and the dramatic pause to use some software to determine the length of this thing, it's so many, an inch and a half or something like this, and it's maybe a 16th of an inch thick or somewhere along those lines. It has a certain volume, and you looked at this, and you could see what the volume of this is. You could use that to deduce the number of matchsticks can't be greater than some number. We know the number has to be 0 or 1 or 2, and you could deduce, based on those facts about the measurements of these kinds of things, the maximum number, as long as you assume this matchstick is representative of the matchstick inside. If it isn't, well, then that maximum number will change. We could guess that the number is probably not 100,000, unless the matchsticks are very, very thin. Very, very tiny and very, very thin, so much that it's just very flimsy and they would have almost no structure to them whatsoever. That could happen. I didn't say it couldn't. So we have to constrain our thoughts. Right now we see the hint to the answer, or that is the answer. The answer is we premised our belief on the number of matchsticks that are in here on certain arguments that we accept. They don't have to necessarily be true, but they have to be at least arguments that we accept. We accepted, if we accept the matches in here are all like this, more or less, then we know there can't be too many in here. There's not going to be, for instance, there can't be even as many as, 100 in there. But if we allow ourselves to think, well, this can be, the matchsticks in here are gorditos or something, very big, thick matchsticks, well, there could be 4 or 5 in here maximum. Or if we imagine they're just wispy, thin things on the order of a human hair or something like this, well, there could be 100,000 in there. Still, you don't know. You're only guessing. But you can tighten that guess more or less depending on the premises that you assume. So what we've done with this thing, this very humble matchstick, is created a perfect random number generator. We've only created one random number, that's true. Whether or not that's useful, that's up to you to decide. However, it is a random number. It is truly random. Nobody knows what it is. Only the Lord himself knows what this number is. I have almost certainly used matches out of this box in the years since I've got it. I have no memory of how many I've used, but there may be some in there. I don't know. I know there's some in there. Ah, here we go. Maybe you heard this. Let's see. Can you hear that? Aha. That tells us something right there. Now, based on that information, to make that rattling sound, and assuming that rattling sound is made by the matches, why then we constrain our guess even more. But still, the number is random. The number itself is random. You may be able to change it one way or the other, depending on the premises that you assume. But nobody will be able to guess what that number is. It doesn't matter what computer you use. It doesn't matter if you have a quantum computer. It doesn't matter anything. This is just as good as a quantum mechanical experiment when you're trying to measure, say, the spin of some particle or something, one particle. It doesn't matter. You can't guess what's in here. You don't have enough information. Therefore, there's no way to know. This is a truly random number to you. Well, we could open it up and look. Let's see. I don't even know. I'm not going to count them here because I think there's more than we want to count. Let's see if I can do this one-handed. Not so easy to do. I'm biting it. Okay, what do we got there? Somebody will tell me there's a couple that are upside down in there. Somebody can count that on things. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. Maybe I miscounted. I counted fast, but there's 21. Assuming I counted. See, there's another assumption, another premise. I counted right. Now, it's no longer random. The number of matchsticks in this box, which you see they're not exactly the same. They're a little thicker, in fact. We see now that they're thicker. We can get a close-up on these kinds of things. The ones in there are thicker and longer. The number, however, is no longer random. It's now known. The random number generator, the wave function on this random number generator has collapsed to a definite value based on a measurement. Now, what you could do is try to repeat this experiment. And in fact, I have a second random number generator. There we are. There's a second random number generator. Now we've got a lot more information from this one. Basically, that we know now the size of these things. We know how many it can hold. Would it look fairly full, but not necessarily completely full? 21. But this one may be completely empty, or it may be up to 21. It may be more. But we know it's certainly not going to be something like 100 or something. But this is another random number generator. We're able to constrain the guess of the number on this one based on the information we have in here. That's true. We now know more about this than we knew just starting with this, because we took measurements on this. But that still does not tell us exactly what this is going to be. There is a cause of this number of matchsticks in here, and we do not know the cause. Those causes are various. It depends on who manufactured this, who stuffed them in there. I don't know anything about those kinds of causes, but they exist. And part of the cause is the material cause. Well, we know that the material cause is the thickness of this match and the length of it, the thickness of this box. The formal cause is the form of this whole setup, but we don't know the efficient cause. The number we know the final cause. People wanted to stick matchsticks in here. We don't know, unfortunately, the full efficient cause, so we don't know the exact number, but we can constrain it now. We can constrain this. We might now change the probability that there's a certain number of matchsticks in here. But we're not going to be able to know. We still don't know. This is still a random number generator. And there's no cause that is going to be able to tell us. Because this is not a factory fresh box. This is a box that has seen use over a great many years. So that's the way it is. That's the way all random number generators are. If we do not know the full cause, and it's material, it's formal, it's efficient, it's final cause, the full cause of what the thing we're measuring is, then the outcome is random to us. If we do know those causes in full, then the outcome is not random to us. And this one, the outcome is no longer random because we know all of the causes. This one, we don't know all of the causes, so the outcome is still random. If we know part of the causes, for instance, the material cause, we know the size and shape and all that kind of stuff, we can constrain our guess. We can constrain the probability, but we still do not know. The number is still random. Now, that's the same for anything in the world. Anything in the world. Randomness is a matter of information, and that's it. It means unpredictable, and it means more or less ignorance. It means ignorance of cause, and cause in its fullest form. Not just the efficient cause, but the full range of causes of what brings something into being. So that's what randomness is. So we know these are a random number generators. This one is no longer a random number generator. This one still is. And even this McCormick and Schmick's, that one's a random number generator. You don't know what's going on in here. You may be able to, again, use what we've learned from all these to make a guess. But then would it apply to this one here I picked up in Michigan? Wild Bill's tobacco. Rocky Patel, form of cigar on the back right there. And on. So these are all random number generators. You can constrain those guesses now better, but the number inside, you don't know. And because you don't know, it's unpredictable, because you don't know those causes, by definition, the outcome is random. And that's the same for any random number. So we don't need to use complex setups. We don't need to look at cosmic rays from space or anything like this, clicking over in some circuit that we designed, although that's a lot of fun to do. We've generated them just the cheapest possible way by picking up these free matchsticks. I hope you've understood randomness a little bit better because of this video, but if not, I'll have plenty more in the future. Thanks for listening, and of course, light 'em up.